and Democrats looking to make an impact in the March LegCo by-elections. Fears of a new tainted water scandal at another public housing estate. And the enormous cost of the Sha-Tin essential oil. Hello and a very good evening. Six PAN Democrats have declared their intention to run in the Legislative Council by-elections in March. They will take part in a series of primaries that will take place in the middle of the month. Sharon Tang tells us more.
The six aspiring candidates gathered today to announce their participation in the primary elections. Frederick Fong, Edward Yu, and Raymond Yun will compete for candidacy in the Kowloon West constituency, with Ken Zeng withdrawing from the race at the last minute. Meanwhile, Gary Fan, Stephen Kwok, and Tommy Cheung all want to be the Pan-Democratic camp's sole candidate in the New Territories East constituency. Politicians showed up today to give their support for the contenders and the Power for Democracy, the group that's organizing the primary.
Be smart online. Don't download suspicious mobile apps. Don't use an easy-to-guess password for all accounts. Installing a webcam without security settings, footage could be intercepted. Ignoring privacy settings in a social network account, personal data could be exposed. Don't use free public Wi-Fi recklessly. Delete preferred networks after use. Change online password regularly. Be smart with password security.
不論在工作上遇到幾多困難，我哋都會不偏不倚，執行職務。即使查案搜證嘅過程好似大海撈針，我哋都唔會放過任何一個線索。有市民嘅支持同協助，我哋會繼續。Be carried out among members of the public selected through random sampling. This process will begin in mid-December and will account for 45% of each contender's final score. Then, on January 14th, voting stations will be set up in Kowloon West and New Territories East. The results will also account for 45% of each contender's final score. The other 10% will be determined by the opinions of some 20 community groups. The final results of the primaries will be announced on January 15th.
For the phone interviews, the Hong Kong View Public Opinion Program has developed certain mechanisms to have checks and counter-checks to ensure that a high proportion of the respondents will be genuine and honest in their responses.
Meanwhile, the by-election date will clash with the annual meetings of the National People's Congress and the Chinese People's Political Consultative Conference in Beijing. Chief Executive Carrie Lam said the government respects the Electoral Affairs Commission's decision. The nomination period for the by-election will run from January 16th to 29th. The Pan Dems today called on Hong Kongers to get out and vote so they could have a shot at winning back some seats. Sharon Tang, TVB News.
Now to a possible new tainted drinking water scare. The Democratic Party is urging the government to provide residents of a Sha-Kei-Wan public housing estate with safe drinking water. This comes after test results found the water was contaminated with chemicals. Here's Anne-Marie Center.
This is what comes out of the tap if you live in Oi Tung Estate. Look closer and you'll see the water is not only a strange colour, it contains what appear to be black particles. More than 30 public housing estate residents complained to the Democratic Party over the past year. The opposition party passed on their complaints to the water supplies department.
They have taken 14 samples within the Oi Tung estate, and then they have recently replied to us that the water samples that they have tested are all safe and are all up to standard, and it's safe for residents drinking.
Unconvinced, the party commissioned a government-certified lab to carry out tests over the past month. The results out today showed the water contained lead, aluminium, iron, zinc and copper. Lead made up nearly 30% of the impurities found.
We are so astonished that why in drinking water from water tap, we would find metals.
Hui wants the government to provide the residents with safe drinking water for the sake of their health.
I'm not convinced at all that it's safe. From the report, it doesn't say that the metals has been melted into the water, so that if you drink it, it's imminently dangerous. But of course, it's only common sense to all of us, right? When you drink water and you use the water with washing your food and with when you cook, it's easy to absorb those materials and metals and into your body. And we believe that in the long run, it will harm people's health definitely.
The lawmaker added that despite the water supplies department responding to the complaints by installing some water filters in the estate last year, the water quality was still not up to standard. He wants the government to carry out a more in-depth probe into the source of the impurities. Anne-Marie Sim, TVB News.
The MTRC's Shah Inter Central Link budget estimate has now ballooned to $97.2 billion, making it the most expensive rail project in Hong Kong's history. That's more than 21% above the budget of $79.8 billion. The surge in costs came down to several factors, such as a lag in construction progress due to the discovery of ancient wells at certain sites. The government's late handover of work sites in Wan Chai was also blamed. Authorities plan to ask the Legislative Council for the extra funding in a timely manner. Well, the chief executive today backed the Legislative Council president's plans for the debate on changing council rules to curb filibustering. Carrie Lam also denied the government was holding back on tabling bills to lawmakers to clear the way for tomorrow's debate. Amory Sim reports.
Yesterday, Legislative Council President Andrew Leung decided that all proposals from both the pro-establishment and opposition camps would be discussed in one combined debate. Each lawmaker has 15 minutes to speak on 54 amendments. That's about 16 seconds per amendment. Leung has also set a deadline for the debate to finish before Christmas. With the debate due to start tomorrow, the chief executive said she respected Leung's decision as reasonable, since under Article 72 of the Basic Law, it was his responsibility to ensure LegCo ran smoothly. Lam added that it was understandable the LegCo chief wanted to complete the debate on changing the rules of procedure so the legislature could move on to other items. She pointed out that LegCo had held 8 meetings since October, but was only able to pass the motion of thanks for her policy address and the non-binding motion on the co-location arrangement for the high-speed rail link.
Maybe this phenomenon is very unusual, and we hope that things in the Legislative Council will be brought back to normal as soon as possible.
The government did not table any bills for LegCo's weekly meeting today. That led to the PAN Democrats accusing her administration of using that as a strategy to pave the way for tomorrow's debate.
There is no particular tactics or strategy. We will submit the bills and resolutions when they are ready for LegCo to discuss and debate.
The pro-establishment camp is set to move 24 proposals to the rulebook tomorrow. If those changes are passed, the opposition camp will lose most of its powers to wage delaying tactics. Since the courts disqualified 6 pan-democratic lawmakers, the camp no longer has enough votes to block proposals that reach the voting stage. Anne-Marie Sim, TVB News.
Overseas now, British Prime Minister Theresa May failed to clinch a deal yesterday to open talks on a post-Brexit free trade agreement with the European Union. This comes after a tentative deal to keep EU rules in Northern Ireland and ensure an open border on Ireland angered her allies in Belfast.
It all seemed so promising yesterday for British Prime Minister Theresa May. There were hopes that sweeping agreements would be announced on key issues, such as how much the UK should pay to leave, the rights of citizens, and ensuring open borders on Ireland post-Brexit. But after arriving in Brussels quietly optimistic for a breakthrough, May and the British government were left empty-handed after no agreement was reached on the Irish border.
Despite our best efforts and the significant progress we and our teams have made over the past days on the 3 main withdrawal issues, it was not possible to reach a complete agreement today.
Juncker held out hope, though, that a breakthrough could be reached when EU leaders meet later this month. But without a solid commitment to having open borders on Ireland, the UK and EU cannot move ahead to the next phase of talks, which would include discussions on a future trade pact. The last-minute disappointment came yesterday when the Northern Irish Democratic Unionists, who are coalition partners with the Tories, refused to accept the tentative deal, which would mean keeping EU rules in Northern Ireland.
We have been very clear, Northern Ireland must leave the European Union on the same terms as the rest of the United Kingdom, and we will not accept any form of regulatory divergence which separates Northern Ireland economically or politically from the rest of the UK. And the economic and constitutional integrity of the United Kingdom must not be compromised in any way.
May's setback has emboldened her critics, especially those pushing for a softer version of Brexit. Scottish leader Nicola Sturgeon said May's failure to seal a deal could signal the moment for renewed efforts to keep Britain in the European single market and customs union. But this is opposed by the hardcore fans of Brexit, who say it defeats the purpose of leaving the EU in the first place.
The three-year-old civil war in Yemen has taken a new turn as former president and long-time strongman Ali Abdullah Saleh was killed. This comes just days after Saleh switched sides in the war, abandoning his Iran-backed Houthi allies in favour of the Saudi-led coalition that backed exiled President Abdel Rabu Mansour Hadi. Alan Buckley reports.
Houthi rebel militia say Saleh's armoured car was hit by a rocket and then he was shot dead south of Sana'a. They later set fire to his home in the capital city. It was a grisly end for Saleh, who ruled Yemen for more than three decades until an Arab Spring uprising forced him to step down in 2012. It's a huge morale boost for the Iran-backed Houthi rebels and a serious blow to the Saudi-led coalition that intervened in the conflict to try to restore the internationally recognized government of President Hadi. Any hope the coalition had that Saleh could help turn the tables against the Houthis have been dashed. In a televised speech, Houthi leader Abdul Malak al-Houthi described Saleh's death as a historic victory against the conspiracy of betrayal. Speaking from Saudi Arabia, where he's in self-imposed exile, President Hadi urged Yemenis to unite against the Houthis, who he described as Iranian militias. A spokesman for the United Nations called the situation deeply disturbing.
It obviously adds an extreme level of complexity to already a very difficult political situation. We have seen extremely worrying rise of violence in Sana'a, as I've mentioned, over the last few days. This only adds another layer of suffering to the people of Yemen, especially right now those in Sana'a, as we said, where civilian infrastructure being targeted, ambulances are being attacked.
Health conditions in Yemen continue to deteriorate amid the civil war and the Saudi-led blockade of the country. The UN has urged Saudi Arabia to lift the blockade, or Yemen could face the largest famine the world has seen in decades. Alan Bukdia, TVB News.
Back locally, the judge in the DR Beauty Centre manslaughter trial has begun guiding the jury towards making a decision. In order to return a guilty verdict, the judge said the jury must decide whether the three defendants breached their duties to care for their customer as well as four other criteria. Winner Wong tells us more.
DR Beauty founder Stephen Chow, lab technician Chan Kun Chung, and Dr. Mak Wan Ling were at the High Court again as their manslaughter trial entered its final stage. In 2012, a 46-year-old woman, Chan Yun Lam, died after receiving a cosmetic procedure at DR Beauty. Chow, Chan, and Mak have each been charged with one count of manslaughter. In guiding the jury panel, High Court Judge Judiana Barnes said, there are five major criteria that must be met before the jury can declare the three guilty. First, whether the trio owed the victim a duty of care. If not, or if the jury isn't sure, then the verdict must be not guilty. If Chow, Mac, and Chan did owe the victim that duty, then it should be decided whether they breached that duty and whether they were aware that by breaching that duty, they would put their customer under a serious risk of death. If the jury decides the defendants breached their duty knowing of the risk, then they should move on to consider whether their negligence was the main cause of Chan Yun Lam's death. And finally, it should be decided whether their negligence was serious enough that they should be put under criminal sanctions. The judge said, as a doctor, Mak Wan Ling obviously owed the victim a duty of care. Her employer, founder Stephen Chow, claimed he no longer dealt with the company's day-to-day operations, which means he didn't hold a duty of care. However, Judge Barnes said Chow's role is up to the jury to decide, according to the evidence and testimonies they saw and heard. As for lab technician Chan Kun Chung, members of the jury need to decide whether he had the duty of care because he prepared the victim's blood product. The judge will continue giving guidance to the jurors tomorrow, and the jury panel is expected to begin deliberation on Monday. Winna Wong, TVB News.
Fee caps and globally diversified investment. If you've never given investment instructions, your trustee will send a notice to let you choose whether to invest your MPF benefits according to the DIS.
The final dry during the day tomorrow, temperatures between 18 and 22 degrees. That's all the news for now. Thanks for watching TVB. Have a very good night.